Actually, I moved from Rome to Parma 2 years ago, but I'm still have connections in Rome, so it works anyway. So thanks to the ANFA board for inviting me here, and it's a pleasure for me to be here and to present part of my work. And before start, I would like to introduce the presentation, saying that I devoted the first part of this talk to some methodological aspects. As Professor Magagno said, it's important to know what we are doing, what we are measuring. So basically, I will introduce a basic concept of DEG and some technological aspects of virtual reality. Then I'd like to move to present some results from research about aesthetics and architecture. So, just to start, what's neuroimaging? When we speak about neuroimaging, we can talk about two different types of neuroimaging. There are some techniques dealing with structural brain imaging, and they are able to retrieve information about the structure, tissues of the brain. Instead, I am more interested to functional brain imaging. Those are the techniques retrieving neurophysiological activity from the brain. That is to say, EEG and fMRI. But they are able to measure two different things. EEG retrieves electrical activity coming from different cortical layer of the cortex. Instead, fMRI is the signal coming from the fMRI are more connected to variation of the metabolism and basically blood flow, actually. So the EEG that we measure from the scalp surface comes from a signal which is generated from a large assembly of neurons within different layers of the cortex. Basically, this signal is not generated directly from the spikes of neuron, but the summation of the potential that this signal is able to generate post-synaptic connection, the summation of this signal propagates from the cortex to the scalp. And this generates the EEG signal that conveys information both in the temporal and in the frequency domain. The picture that you are able to see here, it's the EEG signal filtered in different frequency bands. And each band, we know that can give us information related to cognitive, affective states, and also information to the activity of the motor system. So, as you probably know, the EEG is a non-invasive measure, and we have different devices to collect these signals. Today, we have several companies producing portable EEG devices that are able, are easy to use. However, we can also have a more complicated set here of electrodes measuring more sources in order to try to get an estimation of the cortical generator of the EEG. As we know, the EEG is a simple measure. One of its advantages is that we can have a high resolution of the temporal domain, but the spatial resolution at the scalp level is quite poor. So by using some more advanced technique and applying some anatomical and functional constraint, we are able to get an estimation of the generators of DG. And in this way, we can improve the spatial resolution of this technique. From the technological point of view, why virtual reality is important for architecture and neuroscience. Of course, with the virtual reality, we are able to reproduce and create environments, and we can ask people to explore this environment as they were in the reality. Dealing with virtual reality, we have to take into account two dimensions. The first one is technological, and we speak about immersion. So these different devices are able to increase the level of immersion of the subject experiencing these tools, like a 3D monitor and power wall and the cave system. So the cave system is able to get more immersion with compared with this head-mounted display. Another important dimension is the one of presence. In this case, we are dealing with some some psychophysiological aspects, because with presence we mean that people are experiencing the virtual environment like it is real, in the sense that these scenarios are able to increase the physiological parameters like the heart rate variability or the galvanic skin response as they are in the reality. An example of this phenomenon is I took this picture from the study of Zlobunov and colleagues a few years ago. They nicely reproduced this room in two different ways. There's a 3D scenario, and they compared the experience of navigating this scenario with one provided to the subject in two dimensions with a simple monitor. And they showed that in the encoding phase of the three-dimensional scenario, there is an increase of the frontal midline activity of the EEG in the theta band when compared to two-dimensional condition. And this is another clear sign of presence. The second part of the presentation is devoted to the EEG correlates of aesthetic experience. I would like to start with the works by Gallese that postulated the fact that the motor system is implicit engaged during the experience of works of art, both with the sculpture and paintings like that. Because when we observe these artifacts, our body is implicitly engaged. And another important framework about neuroscience and aesthetics is the one prepared by Chatterjee and Bartania. And they recognized the importance of the sensory-motor circuits to engage the aesthetic experience. However, they stress also the importance of some other aspects of human being to perceive this aesthetic experience. That is to say, the aspects related to, for instance, reward, emotion, but also aspects related to context and culture are very important to elicit the experience the aesthetics. These experiments come from the group by Gallese, and they show the engagement of the motor cortex during the experience of these paintings by Lucio Fontana. In this case, this EEG activity is compared with the activity coming from the observation of these control stimuli that were prepared in order to cancel the movement from these the original works. And they found out that there is an engagement of the motor cortex during the observation of the original stimuli in the alpha band. Similarly, they also did another experiments using different pictures, the works by Franz Kleind, and similarly, they used these control stimuli which comes from, they are prepared in order to cancel the movement of the strokes of the paintbrush. And in this case, these results show as well the activation of the motor system here. These are the parietal activations here, bilateral, but also some cortical network related to reward here, and also the orbitofrontal cortex engaged in the judgment tasks. So these results proves the activation of a very broad system of the cortex. Another experiments related to architecture. Thanks to these results, we decided to perform an experiment designing these three different interiors, which were provided to subject within a cave system. So each subject experienced these three systems. And after that, they were asked to give a rating of according to the sense of presence, pleasantness, comfort, arousal, novelty, and familiarity. So, and according to their own ratings, the G activity were analyzed. The aim was to try to see if the motor system and those complex cortical areas could be engaged by this stimulation. So first of all, we investigated the dimension of presence, and we found out some results similar to the one that I showed before, in the sense that high presence is correlated with an increase of the frontal theta activity, basically in the middle of the experience. This result is also accompanied by an increase of heart rate variability in the central part of the observation of the environments that were judged as to be more engaging more presence. Looking at the dimension of pleasantness and comfort, we also retrieved an increase of activation in blue, the same time window of the experience, in areas devoted to visual spatial navigation in the alpha band, and in the mu band, which is between alpha and theta, and this is a typical EEG rhythm coding motor activity. We see an engagement of these areas and frequency band when people experience more comfort in the rooms. So to conclude, I can say that this experiment with the virtual reality was able to engage the EEG system, and we were able to find some results related to sensorimotor integration with the increase of the frontal theta, and also results that are correlated to visual spatial processing, and motor areas were mostly engaged during the observation of comfortable environments. And that's all, and thanks for your attention. I don't know if you have questions, or can be for the panel. Okay. Yes.
Can you draw any conclusions or interpretations from the results that you showed about the differential in response to those three images?
Yes. Thanks. Yes, that's the slide. So basically, here we have this activation is related to the perception of interiors that were rated more pleasant. So in this case, the activity of the alpha band says that these sites are more engaged during the observation of the interiors that were rated as pleasant. And we know from literature, also by a study performed with the fMRI, that simultaneous activation of this area is related to visual spatial processing. Similar results can be similar interpretation can be done with this map, in the sense that the desynchronization of the alpha activity across motor areas tell us that the motor system is engaged. And since this comparison is depicts the comparison between interiors rated as high with high comfort against interior with low comfort, we can say that this is a sign of activity of the motor system when subject is comfortable in an interior. So that's.
So, I'm sorry, with all due respect, I don't think you understood my question. Yeah. Oh,
probably. No, I mean, our analysis is performed according to the ratings of the subject. We did not, I cannot provide any results related to the single interior.
Okay.